Thank you for watching Screen Hoopla. You know, I thought I would do something on a little bit of a lighter note instead of all this crazy politics that's been going on for the past few months. President Trump has made strides in so many areas in government since he took office that it spins your head, but it doesn't seem to bother him at all. He has a packed agenda and knows what areas to target. President Trump takes on issues that other presidents have shied away from and avoided, and he does it fearlessly. And I think it's safe to say we tend to go more on what President Trump does than what he says. If you look at his actions and what he has accomplished, it is mind-blowing. And he has done it for all Americans, regardless of race, sex, or religion. This past week, President Trump held a roundtable discussion at the White House concerning prison reform. One of those attendees, a black pastor, was very vocal in praising President Trump and his efforts. He dropped a bomb at the White House roundtable describing President Trump as possibly the most pro-black president he'd seen in his lifetime. That says a lot about Barack Obama, doesn't it? This administration has taken a lot of people by surprise, and it's going to surprise you guys even more because this is probably the most provocative administration regarding urban America and the faith-based community in our lifetime. Pastor Scott is a member of Trump's National Diversity Coalition. He also served on President Trump's transition team, and he stated, to be honest, this is probably going to be the, and I am going to say this at the table, the most pro-black president that we've had in our lifetime. And I try to, you know, analyze the people that I encounter. This president, meaning President Trump, actually wants to prove something to our community, our faith-based community, and our ethical community. With low record unemployment in our black community and race no longer being a divisive issue, well, when it comes to President Trump, I am sure that is true. Pastor Scott is right. President Trump's economic efforts are working because he is not focusing on identity politics or one group of people. He's improving the entire economy of the United States and bringing back jobs to Americans. He is removing regulations and taxation that literally have crushed innovation and entrepreneurship in this country. President Trump has fired up the capitalistic engine of America once more, and because of that, prosperity is hopefully returning to all of Americans. He's simply taking government out of the way and letting people succeed if they choose to do so with a hand up, not a hand out. President Trump has also been busy rectifying what he sees as injustices as he can. He pardoned Jack Johnson last month, who was the first black heavyweight champion and who had been convicted under the Mann Act for having a relationship with his future wife, who was white at the time. That was horrifically unjust, and the pardon let the world know how wrong it was. But did you hear about it in the media? Well, of course not. It was ignored because it made Trump look good. Obama did not grant that pardon to Jack Johnson, even though many lobbied him to do so. President Trump also commuted the sentences of Alice Johnson, a 62-year-old grandmother who was serving a life sentence for a nonviolent drug offense. The president is also reviewing other instances of miscarriages of justice. Not all of them I agree with, but many are the right thing to do. President Trump has also signed an executive order that moved the White House initiative on historically black colleges and universities from the Department of Education back to the White House to strengthen the office. He has gone out of his way to uplift and to strengthen the black community. President Trump has also shown that every step of the way since he's came into office. I would say President Trump has made an excellent start at rectifying injustices that have far too long been ignored. He's done many good things since he's been in office, but the left wants only to talk about Russia, an issue that is non-existent and nothing but a distraction from what needs to be done. It is obstructionism in its most political form. The proof is in President Trump's actions and what he has done for the black community and Americans in general. It sure makes Barack Obama look weak in comparison.
To a great education that leads to a lifelong career and success and all of the things that go with great success. We also underscore the crucial importance of faith in fostering strong families and communities. And I just want to again thank you all for being here, and you're very special people. I don't even know if you know that, but you're very special people. You're admired by everybody in this country. Even if they're not believers, most of them admire what you're doing. But maybe we'll make them believers, right? We're going to work. And I'd like to ask John Gray if we might, if you could just start off with a prayer. Would be great. Thank you, John.
God, we thank you for an opportunity to speak about the hearts of those who sometimes cannot fight for themselves. Thank you for this moment to be able to share our hearts with the president and his administration. Dr. King said, we cannot influence a table that we are not seated at. And so we pray that this conversation will be fruitful and productive and honoring of the best traditions of this nation. Yes. We further pray that you will continue to give wisdom and insight to our president and his leadership team to be what our nation needs to build this country from the inside out, that we will continue to be a beacon of hope and light around this world. Bless his family, bless his health, and everything that he puts his hands to do. Yes. This is our prayer, and bless our time together. Jesus, in your name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, sir.
I think he's done that before. What do you think? I appreciate it. Thank you. Maybe we could go around the room and we'll start, well, my friend, from the beginning.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes,
maybe sir. Just say a couple of words, if you will.
I'm so blessed and honored to be here and to be able to pray right here in the White House. And the most recent thing I've noticed that you've done so many things that were great. Everybody expects me to talk about the life and the babies, and I could do that, but you opening up the steel mills. And I lived across the street, pastors, in front of a steel mill in Birmingham. Now that's when they were bombing us and everything. But the people were at work. So they could go to church, they could give tithes, they had pretty dresses to wear on Sunday, and they weren't hungry. So you said you were going to reopen those steel mills.
They're opening.
I'll leave it at that. I won't take too much time.
The dumping is stopping.
But
you know,
I saw
dumping.
That. I saw it.
The
yeah.
dumping is stopping, and the steel mills are opening.
Yes.
United States Steel just announced another two plants.
Mm-hmm.
They're up to eight. Nucor just yesterday opening a big one, a brand new one, $250
so
million
glad.
Dollars in Florida. The steel mills are coming back, and we need steel in our country.
We do.
We need it for defense. We need it for a lot of reasons. We can't let that happen. They were ready to be gone. It was ready to be extinct. We had to get our steel from other countries. We can't do that. So
thank you
for mentioning
really,
that.
Thank you. I saw
thank
that.
You. Yeah, they're really open. It's, a,
like
it's an incredible story. Please.
All right. John Ponder, Las Vegas, Nevada. First of all, Mr. President, I'd like to thank you for recognizing me on the National Day of Prayer for the
yes.
transformative power of Jesus that had worked in my life. Since that day, I echo your sentiments that the work that's being done in the reentry community as a result of prison reform, there are a lot of employers out there right now that are willing to hire people who
right.
are coming home from the prison system. One of the things that we've learned was that employers are not willing to hire people. They're not willing to hire projects. And because of the existing initiatives, when we're able to help them to be tremendous assets to the employers and not liabilities, then they're hiring them all day long. So we just thank you for the direction that the country is going in, specifically as our partnerships with law enforcement are beginning to grow. Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department has given us over 60 men and women from the police department that are serving as mentors and trainers for people coming home from the prison system. And I think that is a direct result of the direction that our country is going in. So I thank you and your administration for the hard work.
Well, thank you very much. And you know, it's something that should have been done a long time ago, prison reform. And Paula and Jared, I want to really thank you for the job you've done. It's really incredible. But a lot of people are saying, you mean it's the Trump administration that's doing this? You understand. They don't believe it. But we're really making a tremendous amount of progress, and it's a beautiful thing to watch. Thank you, John.
Mr. President, Reverend DeJesus from the city of Chicago, from the community of Humboldt Park, New Life Covenant Church. First of all, let me just say thank you for your boldness. Thank you for taking a stand for those that are disenfranchised. And I want to say that in the city of Chicago, there are so many pockets that's not talked about revitalization. And I know this is something in your heart, a rebuilding communities. And I look forward to partnering with you and this and your administration to revitalize the city of Chicago.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Mr. President, my name is Van Moody from the Worship Center in Birmingham, Alabama. And I just want to continue to underscore what's already been said. Thank you for your heart for all people, but particularly your leadership on the issue of prison reform and workforce development. Those are two of the biggest issues facing Alabama. A lot of the individuals that we spend a lot of time ministering to are really hard hit in those areas, corporations. That's the biggest issue right now in Alabama. So thank you for your leadership on this issue. Thank you for being compassionate and caring about all people.
Great state, too. Yes. Great people. Thank you.
Mr. President, Kyle Searcy, Montgomery, Alabama also. I want to echo all that's been said. We're very grateful for your heart toward criminal justice reform, your heart toward the urban communities. It's very, very amazing. Montgomery, Alabama is a city that's known for unity and bringing people together, and so many things have come out of that city, and it's just very encouraging that you have a heart to begin to bring people together, work across the aisle, and get things done. Many people on our team pray for you every single day.
That's really
thank you, Mr. President.
I appreciate it, folks. Thank you very much.
Mr. President, Philip Goodell from Sacramento, California. And don't give up in California. Please don't give up on California. I'm in Sacramento. I'm right in the capital there. And we're working in every area to try to make a difference in the people's life. So I guess the greatest word I can say for you, Mr. President, is that you have given this country expectations, given us a new hope, a new excitement to believe that things are getting better and going to get better. And we appreciate that leadership, your tenacity to keep pushing in against all the opposition that comes against you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
God bless you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it. John?
Mr. President, John Gray, senior pastor of Relentless Church in Greenville, South Carolina. And I am grateful for the opportunity to be at this table at a time in our country where faith is becoming a bit of a dinosaur. In a time of moral relativism and secular humanism, it is refreshing to know that those of us who have committed our lives to fighting for people who cannot fight for themselves have a seat at the table to share our hearts. I believe that the very best principles of Scripture call us to fight for the poor, for the oppressed, for those who have made mistakes. Criminal justice reform is an opportunity to give a second and third chance to those who want to become productive members of society. Our nation cannot forget the broken. It is in the best tradition of our nation to fight for them. And when I think about the history of the church in this country, we have always fought for those who could not fight for themselves. So when I think of those who are coming out of prison who want to contribute, this is critical. When I think of veterans, I have here the obituary of my uncle who passed away a few weeks ago. He was 77. He was a veteran in the U.S. Army, and he battled through mental illness and other challenges. And we saw systemic poverty, multi-generational poverty. But had he been resourced with the proper care, and had he been resourced with other necessities, he could have contributed even more. And so I'm very grateful for you, for this administration, that's allowing for the conversation. And again, my prayer is that you will continue to have wisdom and insight to lead this nation. Truly, all of us are created equal. And so thank you for giving us an equal opportunity to fight for this nation and what it means to be an American.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
How many people in your church?
Well, we just started 3 months ago, and we have about 5,500, 6,000.
Yeah, that's what I heard. I heard it's really incredible. Very quick.
Yes, sir.
Some of them, 45,000, 50,000 people. Some of you even more than that. So I congratulate you all, and it's an honor to have you here. And you always have a friend in the White House. You know that. Harry, you know that, right?
Yes, sir.